Trevor and Trisha, it's me, Jenny, and it's time for another Not Naked, In Fact Naked Army Tank Top, Naked Truth, where we talk as candidly and as truthfully as possible about a subject of Trisha Hershberger's choosing, straight out the shower, no makeup, absolutely soaking wet hair, first take, one take, so on and so forth. Most people try to choose to do it naked. I choose not to, but either way, it's not a sexy time thing. It's a tool for the vlogger to be vulnerable, honest, and candid, and not with the perfect sheen of, a lot of current media peoples and the pressures that those things put on you. Yeah, and I'm talking slowly for once, not in a naked truth, because, as promised, I'm filming this on my crappy web camera, so the lighting is awful. I'm sure the audio is not great either, but I think an entire decade worth of self-reflection requires me to have more than 5 minutes worth of time. So that is why I'm doing it in this format. So I apologise. I don't know if you guys want to actually, deal with the fact that this quality is not great. But there we go. Hi. So yeah, looking back at the last decade, it's very, I feel kind of torn looking back on the last decade. Because they say people, you change everything about yourself within 10 years. And I don't feel like I've changed that much. I'm sure I have, in certain aspects, actually genuinely in terms of, how I conduct myself to others, and how I express myself. I think self-confidence-wise, I come off as more confident. I know my body has changed a lot over the last 10 years, which I'll go into. In terms of where I was 10 years ago and where I am now, I've kind of come a bit of a circle, which I don't know if it's a positive thing or a negative thing. I guess I better start at the beginning of the decade. So 2009 was a very difficult year. I was 17. I was in my second year of sixth form. And when I was 16 in 2008, I lost a friend. Very suddenly, it was an accident, and I'd known her all my life. And she died in 2008. And it took a long time to kind of process that. And I think a lot of that particular year formed a lot of who I am and a lot of how I view big emotional impacts in my life and how I kind of digest emotion, which I don't know if it's always the healthiest way. Me and my sister do a lot of discussions on this sort of thing where we're like, are we emotionally repressed? So that was something quite significant happened when I was quite young. And it took me a long, long time to process that, as well as it being, the time where it feels like school is everything, and if you don't choose the right things, do the right things at that stage in life, your entire life is ruined. And in 2009, I lost the second of my grandparents, but the first of the grandparents that I knew. My granddad, I never met, he died before I was born, but my mum's mum died in 2009. As well, so that was another thing to process at the time. My dad had quite a severe accident himself, and both at the time and now we kind of laugh about it. We kind of choose to view the whole incident quite humorously, but in context it was not a small thing. That was quite a severe thing. So 2009 was a tricky year. 2010 was when I first went to, middle of 2009 was when I finished and went to uni, which in the hindsight, in the benefit of years, it was either a combination of the wrong time or the wrong subject or doing it for the wrong reasons. I did not enjoy university as much as I ought to have done, and I feel like had I really thought about it, I should have taken a gap year. Or should have chosen a subject which I enjoyed more, because the subject that I chose, I did it because I wanted a smart subject. I wanted a subject that if I, my plan in 2009 was to finish sixth form with great grades, go to university, do a postdoc, or a postgrad, and then maybe a doctorate, because that's what smart people do, and that's how you get good careers. And I got to university and it wasn't the right subject. It wasn't the right reasons. It wasn't the right plan. And something that I still struggle with to this day, although I think one of the things that has changed is I don't care as much, is like I've always been really envious of people who have a plan or have a passion and have like a thing that they aspire to be and want to be, and even if they're not necessarily good at it, the fact that they have that passion to learn and to push themselves is something that I've always envied, and I've never had that. I've never had like the dream thing I want to do. Like I had a couple of dreams back then. Like I was like, I want to be an actor, I want to be a writer, blah 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 blah. But always the sensible part of my brain was like, but do you really? And so going into university without that passion, I think really hindered my enjoyment of it, because I got there and immediately I found it very difficult. I found it very hard to make friends, although I made a couple of really lovely friends who I've now lost contact with. Because I was having such a rough time at uni, I kind of, for the first year, I forced myself to be this outgoing, like, I'm gonna get drunk on the first night in hall, woo! I'm gonna go out clubbing, because that's what people do. I'm gonna, like, do all this fun stuff, which immediately tailed off after about 2 weeks of having fun. But by that point, I had a couple of friends, and we did things at Christmas, and we agreed to move in together for the next couple of years, and, like, they were really good friends who were really lovely to me, and then I just had a miserable time, and I started kind of repressing myself into a little ball of self-comfort, where I wasn't really doing my work properly, and I definitely wasn't doing a good friend thing, or a good housemate thing, and I became very antisocial, very shut down, and that took a long time to kind of work my way out of. And again, I think it was coming off the rough time I had in 2009. So 2011, 2013, I was very in my own space. It took me a long time to kind of work my way out of that and find sensible ways of doing life again. So those friends that I had at uni, they were lovely, like really lovely girls, two in particular, and a couple of other really wonderful people. I did get my first couple of boyfriends. I had my first boyfriend in 2009, so I was a bit of a late bloomer. And then I had another one in university. He was like really lovely, and honestly, both those boys, in hindsight, I was not a good girlfriend. and they were really, really lovely boys, and I really should have, again, I find it very difficult when I'm stressed out to put in energy into certain things, and those are things that maybe, if there was a sliding doors moment, I'd like to go back to and be like, dudes, you were really great. I'm sorry I was a shitty person back then. Like, you just, not, I don't think it was nasty or horrible, but I don't think I put in as much as they did. And they were really lovely guys. So after uni, I came back home and I procrastinated for a couple of weeks until eventually I got my first job, which is a job that I then stayed in for 5 years. During that time, I progressed from very low down the scale, part-time, all the way up to the highest position that the company was going to offer me, which was not a particularly good position. And I found it very stressful, and there was a lot of things that were not within my work audit that I was being asked to do. I was at one point basically doing full managerial duties with none of the credit, nothing on my CV, nothing to work with, and not being paid as such. And so that was the point where I started looking for other jobs. So I got my current job. So I've been in working employment for 8 years, which is terrifying. And I'm kind of a serial monogamist when it comes to workplace relations. Like, I'm not very good, like, in my heart of heart, I kind of want to, like, try lots of different things and maybe do some work experience, maybe like, do a month of, I don't know, working on a cruise ship or something strange. And then, like, my little internal self goes, no, I don't want to do something that might be risky. Oh, no. And there's something very nice and stable about my job. But last year, I remember finding it really stressful because I was so bored because I'd cracked everything. And this year, they've given me so much that I found it really stressful because I've had too much to do. So swings and roundabouts, I guess. So yeah, I think at the moment I like the stability of my job, but I don't know if I love my job. And again, it's one of those jobs that, because I don't have a passion, I fall into a career, which I've had for now nearly a decade. I've had it for 8 years in this particular career. And I've you know, the two different workplaces had a lot of similarities, so I haven't really changed or developed much within that time. I think I've come out my shell a lot more. I think I've learned to talk to people a bit better, both colleagues colleagues. I've gone from being in a position of absolute no power to being the highest position that I can be within my current department. There's two positions above me, but those positions won't be coming free anytime soon. And I'm still the youngest manager within my department, which is lovely. And I think I'm one of the more confident ones. Yay! And that's something that 10 years ago I wouldn't have been able to say. So in terms of my careers, I really, like, I would love to find a passion. I would love to find a thing. I'm like, that's a thing I want to do. But at the moment, I am stable and therefore content. And I have other goals that I kind of want to go into a little bit more. So yeah, that's my work and my physical progression. But what else has happened in that time? So let's see, in 2013. No, it would have been 2012, I think. I went to my first ever RPG party with my sister's boyfriend, who is now her fiancé. And he ran a game based on the computer game Persona 4, and I played Rize. And that was like my first RPG thing, and I was like, this is kind of magical. Where has this been in my life? I don't understand. And so then I did my first ever cosplay based on that character, and I dyed my hair red because I didn't know that wigs, decent wigs, was the thing that people can do. No, I should dye my hair red. So I had red hair for a long time at that point. And I think that was, I think I was still in uni. I can't remember. And then I was trying to get into D&D and RPGs, and I couldn't crack it. And then Role came out, and Critical Role, what year was Critical Role? I want to say 2015, I want to say, and I loved it, and I got completely hooked, and I listened to it again and again and again and again and again, and eventually signed up to a local D&D group where I can remember the first day I turned up to D&D, and I was in the pub, and I sent an email to the head of the group at the time, saying, can I come along? I've always been interested, but I've always been a bit too nervous. And I bought my player's handbook. I turned up to the pub and she said, okay, you're with this guy. He's running a game at the moment, so just he'll invite you in to play. And he's like, have you done it before? I'm like, no, but I've got my book. And he's like, okay, write your character sheet and you can pop in when you're ready. And I was literally flicking through the player's handbook, which is like this thick. And I was so close to crying in the pub. I was like, I don't know what I'm doing. How do I do character builds? What level am I? So I eventually, just that day, I just watched. And then they actually made a beginner's group because a couple of other people were starting, or just they wanted a group. So they pitched for a different DM to come in and did that. And that group of D&D players that was run out of the back room of a pub, which I think at the time when I joined was like under 20 people, is now nearly 70 people. And we have moved venues 4 times, and we are now in the largest venue, and we take up basically an entire community centre once a week on Wednesdays, from 8 till 11, every single week, and I made some of the best friends that I've ever had. And I have DM'd now for a full campaign, which was nearly over a year, of DMing, and I've just finished a block, I think it was a double block, so I've come off 6 months of DMing again, and I'm finally going to play again this next block, which is 3 months, so yeah, I'm really looking forward to it, and I've made some of genuinely the nicest people I've ever known, are now my IRL friends, who we go to movie, like, I've hosted movie nights for them, and I've done homebrew D&D sessions and Halloween sessions, and they're nice to me. I don't understand why. And they're supportive and they're kind, and I homebrew a lot of stuff, and they're like, this is awesome. I'm like, what? One of the things I kind of loved as a kid, or particularly as a teenager, was I would be like, I'm going to be a writer. I'm going to write stories, ha 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 ha, novels. And what I do is I spend a lot of time thinking about the progenitors to the stories. I think about the background, the history, the world. And I never actually put pen to paper on the current plot, because because I couldn't think of interesting ways that the characters interact with the world I built. And so D&D is kind of perfect for that kind of story process, because I can build the world, and the world is fixed, and the world exists, and the players interact with the world, and then, like, honestly, some of the best people I've ever met. Shout out to my current D&D group, Laura, Georgie, Daniel, Rich, and Tim, my current five players, but also, like, huge shout outs to, like, everyone I've ever DM'd for and everyone who's DM'd for me, because I've now had many DMs, and they are wonderful people, and they put so much time and energy and effort into trying to make the stories work. And I've played bards, I've played clerics, I've played barbarians, and D&D is such a lovely part of my life. Like, it's recapturing the joy of when you're a child and saying, you know, I do this because I can, and you do it. And like that extra, like, I will say, if I felt like I could contribute something to the D&D world, I would, because I feel like it's so, like, on weeks when I can't make a D&D session because of work, and again, this year's been quite hard because it's been very busy with work, and there's been a lot of times where they haven't allowed me to have Wednesdays off to go to D&D, or we had a D&D group who currently, I'll give a shout out to Hayley and Alistair and their two babos, because we were on a home game with them, and then they had a babo, and then they had another babo, so congratulations to your little babos. Because of that home game has kind of fallen away. So when I didn't have the home game and I couldn't make it to the club, the society, the Guild of Adventurers, I felt those weeks just really dragged me down. I had no real escapism and no release and no interaction with my friends. I wish there was something I could do to give back to the D&D community other than DMing as much as I can. And hopefully we're thinking about this year, because my summer shift pattern is really, really taxing. I don't really want to DM during that time in the guild, but maybe I'll do something. I might do some home sessions so that my campaign doesn't die, because the world that I built for my current players is massive and sprawling and in my head, and I really want them to get to certain characters and certain elements of the game, and they're starting to peel back some of the layers of the deeper world. And I don't want them to forget that. I don't want them to lose that. And if we do this, at the moment we're playing on hopscotching with my other friend, Tim, my current player, but will be DMing from this block. We're playing on hopscotching, so he'll do 3 months and then I'll do 3 months. But I don't want the storyline to get forgotten, and then during the summer when I'm going to be like crazy busy and crazy stressed and probably not able to make most of the sessions, it makes more sense for me to be playing rather than DMing. Anyway, D&D, like, I have to give as much props as I can to D&D, because in the last 10 years, that's been probably one of the most important aspects of my, like, last 5 years of D&D has been really influential in how I perceive the world, how I communicate, like, the friendship groups I have versus the friendship groups I had before, where I think most of the time before I had D&D, my only friends were a couple of people from school that I remained in contact with. My sister's friends. There was a point where, like, I had serious complex issues about, like, I don't have real friends, I just have my sister's friends. Those aren't real friends because they belong to my sisters, which is stupid because people don't belong to people. But I felt very isolated for a long time, particularly coming off how bad I felt with uni. So actually finding a way to connect with people in a real, empathetic, human way, it's just been lovely. So shout out to that. As a side note to that, another way I've made friends is through YouTube. I don't know when I first started my YouTube channel. Let me have a quick look, because I believe this is my 7th year or my 6th year YouTubeversary. I always have to do this every year. In fact, today is my YouTubeversary. It's Christmas Day, because the first video I say is my YouTubeversary is Christmas Day, because my first ever video response was to Lizzie Bennett Diaries, which is an amazing web series which my sister still hasn't watched, and I don't know why, because it's amazing. Let me just, let's see, what year are we in for your anniversary? I don't even know. I think I'm on 6 or 7. Anyway, I'm gonna, after I film this YouTube vlog, I'm going to be doing my YouTube anniversary video, because I always do a release on my YouTube anniversary. But yeah, so I wish I could remember. I think I'm on my 7th year of YouTube. I wish there was a way that I could just quickly check. I wonder if it's on my YouTube homepage. Sorry, I did not prep properly for this, did I? About. I wonder if it's on my About channel. Joined in 2010. What? What? So I think that's when I made my YouTube channel. Let's see. Okay. So my first ever video was 7 years ago. Yeah. So my YouTube anniversary was 7 years ago. And I joined in 2010. And at the point where I joined YouTube, I'd already watched, I think the first ever YouTube series I watched in full was Imogen Heap, her YouTube channel. And then I watched all of Philip DeFranco. And then at the time when I made a YouTube channel, I was at the point where, I don't know, due to OCD or something, I didn't subscribe to a channel until I watched all of the videos on that channel, which now I just could not physically do. There is just not enough time in the day. But the first couple of people I was subscribed to were Philip DeFranco, the Vlogbrothers, Weezy Waiter, Pineapple Boy Films, when SourceFed came out, obviously SourceFed and SourceFed Nerd, and then a couple other channels here and there that were particularly important, obviously Geeky Sundry. I watched all of The Guild when that came out, which was like a big thing, although I didn't really understand MMORPGs that much, even though I had played WoW in uni and disappeared for like a week. But yeah, so YouTube. So I think, like, obviously a lot of these communities have been really important for all that time. Probably highest up there is The Naked Army, because honestly this is one of the genuinely the nicest community of people I have ever been witness to. Like, Critical Role and Geek and Sundry are amazing, but they're so huge it's almost hard to get like a personal interaction, feel like you have any input at all. But like, I feel like I've been on the ground up with The Naked Army, and it's so important to kind of view people as who they are and not on how they look. Or like, it's just such a lovely way of communicating and kind of saying, look, let's break it down, let's talk for real, let's be honest and vulnerable and truthful and talk about difficult subjects, and if we disagree, then we both learn something. It's not a he said, she said situation, it's a we're different, and it's lovely, and I feel very connected to it. I have since released to my YouTube channel, let's have a look, how many videos do I have? Do I have that on a breakdown? Let's see, videos. So I currently have 548 subscribers, and I have, I don't even know how to look at how many uploads I have. I think it's, I must be close to 1,000 by now. I really should have done some prep before doing this video. But like, YouTube has been a significant part of my life, and on top of YouTube, let's see, 548 subscribers and videos. Let's see, I'm looking at my analytics. This is real time vlogging. It doesn't have a video count. I really wish there was a way of checking how many videos I had. Anyway, I'll look it up. I think it must be nearly 1,000. It must be. That's definitely something for me to look into. Anyway. Is there no count for my videos? Anyway, I'm gonna genuinely stop looking at my analytics. I'm gonna get out of that rabbit hole. So going back to my initial YouTube. I started off with one or two video responses. I did a wink video for Weezy Waiter. I did a video response to The Disappointment Diaries. My first ever video, which I don't technically count as my YouTube anniversary, was me and my sister jumping in the sea in Nine Regis Bay on Boxing Day. So again, Christmassy. But that was like 2 years before my first vlog. And then I started doing the move responses, which was partly a response to try and, like, again, get out of my shell that I kind of formed at that point in my life, and try new things. things, and even watching a new movie seemed really stressful at the time. So I was like, I'm going to push myself to watch new videos. And so I started watching things which I'd never watched before, and started doing movie reviews and doing Philip Franco movie reviews, Sourcehead movie reviews. Then that group of people doing regular reviews formed their own film movie club, which I was part of. And then we filmed a second group of that. And so I've made some really good friends off that. And then I did big significant landmark. I did my first ever international travel on my own. I went to California completely on my own money. And I met up with strangers from the internet, and it was a great time, and not scary and not weird. And I traveled on bus on my own from I left my phone at medieval times, and then everyone else went home. All of the friends I made went to their various places, and I was on my own for the last day without a phone, and I had to go and find the bus service to get me to medieval times to pick up my phone, which had been found by security, thankfully, and then take the bus back to my hotel for the evening, and that was stressful. But I did it, and I did a travel home. I managed to get the flight back and fine, and like, that was a big thing for me. I went to America for the first time, and I travelled alone, and like, I've done a bit of travelling in my life, and I did my first ever, like, lone person holiday, which was in the UK as well. I went to Penzance on my own, which wasn't a very exciting holiday, but it was just me being on my own and accepting that that's fine, and kind of learning to love that, because I've never had a problem with my own company, but socially it's not acceptable to go on holidays on your own, but I love it. Other places I've gone this in the last 10 years, I have ticked off several of my bucket lists. I have been to Venice, I've been to Paris, I have been to Edinburgh, I have been to, where else have we gone? I think Corfu was in the last 10 years, Madeira borderline, I think that was 2009 because I was grieving. Where else have I gone? I've gone to Japan. I went to Japan with my sisters, because my sister's fiancé is currently living there. We went to, did we do Austria? I think we might have done Austria in the last 10 years. Again, America. I did Canada, and again, Canada on my own to go see a friend that I knew from online who was part of the movie club. Shout out to Tor, who is one of the nicest humans on the planet, and a genuine friend, and not just an internet friend. And saying just an internet friend is such a misnomer for the current kind of existence of the internet. But yeah, like, I've made a genuine international friend because of movie club. Like, that in itself is such an achievement, and I have many contacts through movie club, but there's, I think Tor is the only one that is currently like an active part of my life and a wonderful human being, and I'm so excited. And because of Philip DeFranco, because of movie clubs, and because of Tor and meeting her online and doing the chats with our own little movie club, and then going to California, Anaheim for VidCon and meeting her, I'm going to her wedding this year. What? What is this madness? That's crazy, and magical and lovely. So I've done Halloween in Canada now, and I will be doing the summer in Canada, hopefully this summer, as long as I can get time off to go to the wedding. And I've met some YouTubers, Trisha being part of it. I've met Phil, I've met most of the Sourcefed guys when Sourcefed was going, because it was 2014, the height of Sourcefed. Yeah, that's crazy to me. Other big milestones. I learned to drive this year. I finally learned to drive. No, last year. Last year, the year before. Ooh, I've been the year before last. At 26, I'm now 27, so I finally learned to drive. I got myself my little blue Matisse, which I then got into my first car accident with and was written off almost immediately. So that was not so good, not a very positive thing, but I now have my little red Citroen C1, who I call Poppy, and she is lovely and she gets me where I need to go. There's a lot of milestones I still want to do with driving, like I've never done a motorway. I don't have need to, she's a commuter car, like it's literally 20 minutes a day to get in to work, 20 minutes out, and I don't need to go up any big roads to do that, and I haven't done any long journeys with her, so I haven't needed to do any like motorways or anything, but that's something that I want to do in the next year. That's a little target. What else? Like, I've got a few uni. I moved out briefly. I moved into a flat for a full year with a friend from work, and it was very like crazy, spontaneous me. Like, it's not like me to kind of throw myself into stuff. And a new colleague at work was like, I'm looking for a place to live, and I was like, I kind of want to try living outside of home for a bit to kind of get an experience. And she was like, do you want to move in? And I was like, sure. And we found a beautiful flat that I lived in for a full year, very expensive, and chipping into my savings rather than saving, which is part of the reason why I'm now back underneath the Naked Truth poster of Yule, until I can save up. And then my target for the next 3 years, within the next 3 years, I want to own property independently. That is my target. That is my goal. Living with this housemate for the last year has shown me that I really do want my own space. I want my own independence. And I want money to be going into something more permanent than rent. So that's a bigger thing. That's a crazy thing when I think about it. That's a big kind of change in the last decade, where I, like, going back to my kind of goals when I was 17, you know, it was get a degree, get a postdoc, get a job, get married, have kids. Like, that's completely changed. I am now very much in the mindset of stay contented, whatever that may be, get a stable job, keep a stable job, find the joy in what you can, have friends, have a life, be independent, save up. And if I find someone whom I love in that time, then yay. If someone falls out the sky, and it's someone that I feel like I want to invest myself into, which I feel like that's a good way of putting it, because I feel like when you start a relationship, it's like starting a bank account. You start with almost nothing, and you've got to really have a shared goal in mind in order to build up that wealth. And hopefully in a relationship it builds and builds and builds, and sometimes the bank account will be lower and sometimes the bank account will be higher, but generally speaking, hopefully it should be a nice, happy wealth. And there's been no one that I've met in the last 10 years that I've been like, let's do this, let's start from basics, and I want to invest in this relationship. And maybe one day there will be, but I'm not holding out hope, and at the moment I'm happy to be me and be independent and be happy. Going back to anime club, I don't do as much anime as I did, but like, I went to my first three anime conventions, which were really fun. I did cosplay. I think that was a good progression for me. Like, I'm not a big cosplayer, but I love costumes and I love dressing up and hanging out with people and just having a good time. And I very recently reconnected with some of my, again, they're my sister's friends. I know them through my sister, but I consider them my own friends too. The fact that I can consider them my own friends is really important. What else? Project Chronicle. So because of the Naked, not because of Nature, because of Movie Club, one of the other reviewers contacted me, and he's part of a little mini community on YouTube called Project Chronicle. Chris, shout out to Chris, and shout out to all the Project Chroniclers. I won't list you all because I'll miss someone and then it'll be embarrassing, but you guys are amazing. And like, we've hung out, I think, the last 3 New Years. I've rung in the new year with the international crowd of awesome people who we chat for literally hours, and we play games, and they all make me laugh. And I've met Chris in real life. I think I've hugged Matt. I think I hugged Stacey by default. Like, you guys are amazing and awesome and lovely. Everyone I've met from the YouTube community, like, the first ever YouTube meetup I went to was Pineapple Boy Films in Bristol. And it was great. And it was so safe and so friendly, and we ordered nachos, and it was just great. And then, like, I met, who else have I met in real life? I met Matt, like, I went to, like, VidCon, huge number of people I met there, but I've also met a couple of other people. Like, Janelle came to London, I met her in London, I've been to see Tor in Canada, I've met Chris in London, every person that I met from YouTube has been lovely. Sorry, I, like, been still for so long, Trisha, like, little bundle of joy, treasure is wonderful, and I hope to meet you again at some point. Sorry for the shame, yeah. I have hiccups as well, great. But yeah, I haven't had a bad interaction with someone online as yet. So yeah, it's been an eventful couple of years, and I think I've learned a lot about myself. I've changed quite a lot as well. I've loved the last 10 years of getting to know my parents as an adult, getting to learn my sisters as we're becoming mature people. Like, my sisters own pets and they have careers, and they've both grown in and out of love of their careers at the moment, and one of them's gonna engage to be married. What? So it's very like 10 years from 17 to 27 is a huge amount of change. And even though I am currently back in the house that I was still living in when I was 17, and in the bedroom I was in when I was 17, I think personally I've changed quite a lot in that time. I think my body's changed quite a lot. Again, I said I would come back to it. So like I've gone up 2 full foot sizes since I stopped doing ballet, and part of me wants to go back doing dance, but I just don't have the energy. But like in terms of my practical fitness, like last year I was biking 18 miles a day to get in and out of work. So like, my body has changed. I don't know if it's better or worse, but who knows. I cut all my hair off. I haven't had my hair that short since I was 6, and I cut all of my hair off for 3 years for charity. So I cut it right up, and it's still growing, like it's still not long. And that was 3 years ago. I cut off all my hair for charity and raised £600. That was a big thing. I dyed my hair red. Let's see what else happened. I think that's most of the big milestones. There's so much I'm forgetting. It's been 10 years. I lost my other 2 grandparents. So I am currently in a generation where there is no generation above my parents. I've lost the last 10 years. We lost mum's mum, dad's dad, and then dad's mum finally. And all of them were very different losses. And you know, those losses don't go away. It's just something that is part of life. It never gets easier. I lost my cat last year, that I had since I was 13. So you know, that was very sad. What else? Yeah, as I said, both my sisters own pets. What else? Dingy hobbies. I'm just looking at my book and being like, remind me of things that I have done. I think that's most of the milestones. I'm sure there's something I've forgotten. But I've ticked off so many of my bucket list in terms of travelling over the last couple of years. I still want to do I want to do Ireland next year. Never done Ireland. I live right next door to Ireland. Never done Ireland. I still want to do Australia and New Zealand again. Like I've done Australia before, I've never done New Zealand. I want to do that, even if it's on my own. I want to do Egypt. Has always been like a bucket list thing, even though I don't actually know if I'd like Egypt because it'll be touristy and sweaty and sandy and gross. But like it's on my bucket list. And right now I'm really, like, work is stressful, but actually when I break down what I like and what I don't like about my job, it always comes out as positive. And it's, like, working and living in Oxford, like, for all of the political strife that is currently going on in England, I can't deny the historical privilege. And that has its negatives and it has its positives, but it's a really... Like, as someone who has always loved history, and has always loved the stories that go with history, living in Oxford is a lovely thing, living and working in Oxford. In terms of other aspects, I'm not going to go into it, because it's not that sort of year. This is a year about me. Thank you, Naked Army, for making me, I think, a better human. I don't know. A more confident human, a more interpersonal human, a human that communicates ideas as honestly as I can. I don't know whether or not I was like that before. I don't feel like I've changed much, but I'm sure I have. Thank you for watching. I'm sorry this has been so very long. Feel free to comment, and I will see you guys all next decade. Bye bye for now.